of a young and growing India. This is why IFLA aims to be the quintessential platform to showcase ideas with potential to inform professionals, funding experts, and mentors to help seed such ventures. Before we begin, we would like to thank our presenting sponsor, Government of Jharkhand, our associate sponsors, National Stock Exchange of India, and Arj Global Foundation, without whom IFLA 2016 wouldn't have been possible. This edition of IFLA is supported by Founder Institute Calcutta Chapter and NASSCOM 10,000 Startups Initiative with Ernst & Young as the process advisor. The event has been conducted and powered by Mivero.com, a life enhancement platform from Calcutta, which aims to facilitate people to pursue their life purposes in a seamless manner to make lives constructive, satisfying, and meaningful. IFLA 2016 had two categories this year, general and student. The pitch for the student category was completed today morning in a closed-door session. We will now start with the presentations for the general category. Each finalist will be given 3 minutes to pitch their idea to the jury panel and 2 minutes for question and answer with the jury. I will repeat this again. Each finalist will be given 3 minutes to pitch their idea to the jury panel and 2 minutes for question and answer with the jury. They will be indicated 30 seconds in advance to wind up the pitch on time. I take this opportunity to welcome our respected jury members who are present here with us for the finals of IFLA 2016. Mr. Sunil Kumar Banwal, Secretary to Chief Minister, Secretary IT and E-Governance and Secretary Industries, Mines and Geology, Government of Jharkhand. A very warm welcome to you, sir. Mr. Apurup Sengupta, Founder and Chairman, Arj Global Foundation and Co-Founder and Partner, Capital Square Partners. A very warm welcome to you, sir. Mr. Kamal Agarwal, Founder and CEO, Law Exactly Software, and also the Chairman of NASSCOM Eastern Regional Council. A very warm welcome to you, sir. And Mr. Sanjay Mehta, Angel and PE Investor. A very warm welcome to you, sir. We welcome our first finalist on stage, Amitava Chaudhary, representing ASC Computer Grassroots.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'll be presenting Smart Elec, or in brief, AC. My sincere thanks to INFOCOM and IFLA 2016 organizers for giving me this opportunity. Smart Elec, or AC, is an 8-module enterprise solution for management of total operations of a large housing complex. It takes care of visitor management, it takes care of ownership and tenancy data, it takes care of services deliveries, it takes care of emergency and disaster management, it takes care of events and relations management, it takes care of common areas, it takes care of finance and accounts management, and also it takes care of legal compliance and readiness management. It's a total enterprise solution, but what prompted me is a negative story. That is, when I used to stay in Bombay in February 2008, there were murders of 4 senior citizens in 3 posh locality flat complexes. And all the criminals could escape from the site. Same way, Mr. Praveen Mahajan, after shooting down Pramod, he could go about 40 kilometers away before he surrendered. So all this prompted us to develop this particular concept of smart elec. Biometrically authenticated the detection and interception of at or before final campus exit of any guest involved in, we are an 8-member team and small team, and biometrically authenticated, authenticated detection and interception at or before final campus exit of any guest involved in act of identity or purpose fraud or suspects for such acts is the most innovative feature of Smart Elec, Visitor Management Module or VM in brief. And it is seamlessly integrated with all other modules, so it makes the total operations of the entire complex very safe and secure. And our Services Management Delivery Module, monitors each and every service delivery chain in a transparent manner to both service recipients and the service providers. As a result, it creates an ecosystem of mutual trust. So this manual system of operations is our biggest competitor who fails to cope up with the number and the area covered. And secondly is the manual systems with assistance also they fail because they cannot do real-time assessment of visit impact, biometrically authenticated visit impact before a guest is allowed to exit from the campus.
30 seconds left.
Okay, so this is not a freeware. It is chargeable at 15 to 20% of the common area maintenance fees collected by a housing complex. And we expect to generate about 16 lakhs in our first year operations after product launch, followed by 28 and 72 as we have given. Measurement of happiness index is our biggest measure of success for this particular product, and we are looking for funds. Okay, yes.
So while the concept is very regular, there is no innovation, I would like to applaud your zest at this age, coming on the stage and pitching for funds.
Yeah. Innovation part of it, I would like to differ a little bit, sir, because innovation is in the protocol that we are developing on third-party fast response non-contact biometric, by which we are binary assessment of real-time basis, a guest whether he will be allowed to go out if he is involved in a fraud or not. That is our protocol, or that is our proprietary content of this particular solution.
Right,
and
right.
That is either.
Right. So the market size in terms of saying that whether this idea or adoption of this going forward, where do you see yourself by 2020? What will be your revenues?
By 2020, we would expect about 30 to 40,000 flats, or which we call it as a 1,000 flat complex as a standard flat
revenue.
Complex.
I'm asking,
so
what
30
will be
to 40 complexes if we are running at our own pace.
Revenue, my
revenue,
straight answer.
Revenue earning wise, it will be about more than 20 crores per annum.
20 crores.
Maybe more.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, yes. Yeah, proof of concept is getting ready.
Do you have photographs of your product or something which you have created?
Yeah, it's not here at the moment. We are making the proof of concept, but some of the prototypes, modules, we have 8 modules. Some of the modules are here with me. I can show it to you. Okay.
I have one question.
Yes, please.
Such concepts are very prevalent in the Western world. If you go to Singapore or US, there are property management software, there are visitor management software. How does it stop from those companies to come and make it work?
I have examined each and every one of them. None of them are doing this real-time assessment of visit impact, biometrically authenticated, mind my word. We are using biometric authentication in a big way. and a fast response non-contact. We are signing an agreement with Aonix Incorporated of Japan for face recognition technology. That is our plus point, and that we will use. So that what we will do is, if a person, I am from steel industry. In steel industry, there is called a dead man's handle. If a man becomes dead, he will not be able to operate that lever. Same way, here also, if a man is dead, he will not be able to certify his guest for an exit from the campus. He will be stopped at the campus gate. That is the thing that we are trying to achieve. And on top of it, because security is not in one place, so it has to be all encompassing, so we are developing other modules also, because there also security threats can be brought in.
My question is, yes, in your revenue model,
yes,
how will you link this with the demand for these services? Because the demand for security, how will you link it to the revenue so that it becomes sustainable? Otherwise, maybe people may not be ready to pay for this security. So it should be a model which people should be more than willing to come forward to.
One is, security is one part, but we have covered almost, because I stay in a 1875 flat complex. I know what are the pain points. We are fighting a case with our developers for last 6-7 years. So that's why we have brought in legal redress management. We have got other modules, say services delivery management. How do you ensure that we have got housejoy.in or so many other companies, but when they come, what have they done to the housing complex, whether they have affected the common assets of the housing complex? Can you determine? Here we are asking...
Excuse me. Let's be specific. He's asking you whether you have done any kind of survey on the demand and the supply side or the revenue side. Let's be specific on that.
Yeah, we have done the survey with Tata Housing. We have done the survey with others, developers of Bangalore.
So what are the numbers? Do you have the numbers with you of that survey?
Which numbers? What exactly do you mean by numbers? We have pieced our concept, and we have done with facility management companies like JLL and Cushman Wakefield. They have all agreed that this service is essential, and they would like to have it as and when we are ready with the total solution. That is the only thing I would like to comment on this.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
We thank our first finalist. We would now like to welcome our next finalist on stage, Dipankar Ghosh, representing Know All Services.
Good afternoon, everybody.
I'm Dipankar Ghosh. I'm with yourmissions.com. We've launched about a month ago.
Kunta eta? Green tata? Eta eta.
Your time starts now.
Excuse me for a second. Oh, okay. All right, thank you.
This is forward.
Okay. All right, sorry about that. Anyway, I'm Dipankar Ghosh. I represent, I'm here to talk about yourmissions.com. It's one of the products of Know All Services. We've got other products which is upselling after yourmissions.com, but that's our entry level product. I like today's theme, transform and disrupt. That's what we're here to do. We're trying to transform the admissions process for schools and colleges. We're trying to create one platform where all parents and students can go and compare details of multiple colleges and select a list of their colleges that they want to, schools and colleges that they want to apply to, and apply to them. And, you know, this takes away all the problems people have about trying to find out when the admissions forms are going to come online, where do they have to go, do they have to run to multiple schools, collect the forms, stand in queues, you know, pay for the admission forms and everything. So we've got this one platform, you know, it's an existing process. Everybody knows how to apply to schools and colleges. So we've simplified and made it convenient. You know, all educational institutions are on our platform. We launched on the 3rd of November. We have about 250 today in less than a month. And, you know, we send you alerts when the admissions are going to come online. So, for example, the school is going to accept applications for 2017-18 academic year. We'll send you an alert that the school is ready to accept applications. And once you apply, you know, we'll send you status updates. You know, here's, you know, applications received, go for the interviews, so on and so forth. And institutions also benefit. They'll have less queries when it comes to the process. So ultimately, we want to bring convenience. We want to transform this process and even in some cases disrupt. You know what happens when it comes to school admissions. So you want to bring some transparency eventually to this whole process of school and college admissions. By creating this one unified platform, level the playing field, everybody's on there. Consumers, parents, students can look in there, schools, colleges, everything, and compare and choose what they want to go, you know, what they want to study. So it's, you know, as you know, it's anxiety filled, and this kind of takes away a lot of that anxiety and makes it convenient. So you fill up, you choose multiple institutions, whether it's schools or colleges, fill up one form, submit it, make one payment, and you're done. You get status notifications. When, you know, when, what's the status of your application at each school, they'll have an ID. And then all of that, whether you're giving interviews, whether the parent interviews, or some admission test and so on and so forth. So we've got a revenue model.
30 seconds.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, we've got a revenue model. You know, we can get convenience fees from, you know, from the application process. We have, you know, schools and colleges can advertise on our platform, you know, when their admission is due, if there's a new school or if there's a new faculty or there's a new department in a certain college, they can announce on their platform, advertise on there. And, you know, things like convenience fees, you know, education continuity plan, we can sell insurance, you know, that pays your fees. We have online counseling and all of that. So in the last, we launched on 3rd of November, here you can see the numbers. We've got lots of schools already on our platform, and we have 80,000 plus page views already. And then all this less than a month and zero marketing efforts from our side. So, you know, we're ready to grow, pan-India and everything.
So you mentioned about almost half a dozen of revenue models.
Yeah.
It seems you've not figured out what's your revenue model. You are going to charge all of them.
Yeah, we've got convenience fees when it comes to, you know, applying.
Just way they come to the mic.
Yeah, we've got convenience fees when it comes to...
So give me a pricing for each of these six. What pricing will be there?
Maybe 100 rupees.
So right now it's
rupees.
All maybes, right? This is not something where you put it down to real pricing, saying that this is how all the revenue stream will work.
We've got all the avenues lined up. And, you know, we just launched a month ago, and we already signed up.
So without the pricing model, you have launched it?
Yes. We have all the price, we have all the revenue avenues mapped
right,
out.
Right. So, but yeah. You have not figured out the pricing model.
We have not figured out exactly how
much we're
going
to charge.
Secondly,
why did you choose this domain name, Your Admissions?
Excuse me?
Why did you choose this domain name, Your Admissions?
It's admissions into everything. It's admissions into schools and colleges and everything. We've already got our website. And you can, you know, it's for your admissions.
Okay. So just to give you a perspective, mm-hmm. you know, shopping.com is not popular.
Yeah.
Right? It's Amazon or
yeah.
Flipkart.
Yeah.
So trying to get a generic name usually does not work. So just focus on that. Anyways.
Yes, I understand. I appreciate your question.
So are you also helping them to apply for the admission in the school?
Yes, we have counseling, which is...
I'm saying whether parents can apply for the admission also through this...
yes, that's exactly what this is. That's exactly what this is. You
so
select...
school are accepting this application?
Yes.
So
yes.
How many schools in Calcutta are already accepting this application? Can you name few?
230...
Can you name few?
Yeah, we have South City International, we have Narayana, we have lots of schools in Howrah, A.K. Ghosh Memorial. It's all there on our network. I mean, there's a lot of schools already. And, you know, it's just a month, you know, since we have launched, and you know, we're just going school to school. We have collected stacks and stacks of admission forms. We have to upload the data and all the
because
schools.
Generally in the school, we're when talking you take to a South form, Point, they charge
we're talking
some
to
fees.
DPS. Excuse me? Yeah.
Generally, when they distribute the form, they check certain documents and they charge a fees.
Yes.
And you're not charging anything.
No, we're charging whatever the school charges.
You already have a revenue model.
Yes. We're charging whatever the school charges. We'll charge a convenience fee on top of that. And then, see, there's two things here. One is you pay for the application, and then once your application is accepted, you pay for the admission. So both of those are on our platform. So yeah, you can apply. You can apply to multiple schools. Yeah, you can select multiple schools, fill out one application, make one payment, and you're listed for applications in all the schools that is in your wish list, that you've added to your wish list.
Yeah, my question is, given this model,
mm-hmm.
why should good school or good college get hooked on to your portal when there is large number of students lined up for getting admission?
Exactly, exactly.
Second, why good student should go to your portal when they know where they have to apply? Because if had it been so easy, given a situation, the very good institutions are not going through the generic portals.
Not yet.
Not many. Like, I apply to Harvard, mm-hmm. I apply directly. I don't go to any portal and then go to Harvard.
That's true.
Yeah, so what incentivizes good schools and good students to go through this, and then only this will work, unless good institutions come on there?
Yes, ultimately it's convenience. Ultimately it's convenience. Say for example you're in Bangalore and you got transferred to Calcutta and you got to move with your family to Calcutta, and now you're faced with the prospect of putting your schools into Calcutta. What do you do? Where do you start? Do you come to Calcutta, go around, search the best schools, look for them one by one, apply to them, or do you come to your portal, and see what's there, and make all your applications ahead of time before your family moves to Calcutta? So that's convenience. So we're trying to get all the schools onto our platform. Eventually, you know, we've got some mass going. We've got schools signing up. We want to transform this process. You know, there's lack of transparency when it comes to admissions in schools and colleges. So we want to transform this process, and I like today's slogan here, disrupt and transform. You know, hopefully we might disrupt some processes too. But yeah, you know, it's ultimately about convenience.
Thank you.
Does it answer your question, sir? Okay.
Thank you very much. We thank our second finalist. We go over to our third finalist, Divya M.R. Bangalore from SDM Institute of Management Development, Mysore.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone, and esteemed members of the jury. I thank INFOCOM and IFLA 2006 for providing a platform to present our ideas. Our idea is a blockchain banker. So this is a digital currency, or our product is the virtual currency. So it's a need of the day where we want to go away from cash transactions, and we want to give a convenient way for people to it's a peer-to-peer financial transaction service we are going to give, where there's no intermediary, there's no bank, there's no... The USP here is we want to avoid the transaction charges, where I can go ahead. We are a two-member team, and I have Prashanti, who is the finance brain of this. I'll go ahead and, yeah. I'll just quickly go to the product. The product here is an app. So it's based on the blockchain model. You might have heard about Bitcoin. So that's where it is. Like, both the sender and the receiver, they have to register on it, and they can actually credit amount, and also that amount can be used for various services. It is like pay time, and we have also a few apps, but they just are like an Ola service where you charge money and they just give you one service. We want to be a parallel to what the regular banks does. So we want to go big time on the virtual currency, which is a need of the day. We are like struggling with cash and demonetization. So this is an idea we want to put it through. So the revenue model currently, the blockchain bank app will follow a free subscription because the consumers are, we want to get more consumers here. That's how we are going to make money. And we want to beat the competition where the Visa, MasterCard, they charge around 1.8 to 2% for all the transactions. Like you pay your electric bill, you get 2% charges on that. And here we want to not only bill payments, we want to go ahead and provide like for everything, to for groceries, you can even buy your breakfast, which is what I see in a company, corporate company, like there are 10,000 people who actually do buy their breakfast and meal paying cash every day. So we have come up with some ideas where there's Sudoxo coupons and all, but that's not as widespread and used everywhere. This, we want to do it in a digital way where you can actually, and you can also transfer the credits to someone. It's also like where you top up for somebody for a mobile. So it can be done. We want to increase the scope. We want to make it an app where you can, pay for services, also credit points to somebody, but you have to be registered on our app. So that's what our success would be.
30 seconds left.
Yeah, would be the getting the users first, then would be of course charging a subscription fee, and then we would try to retain and then make people use it actively on a daily basis. I'll go further. So this is in a summarized way, it's a virtual currency and in a valid digital wallet. So that's what we want to.
Is this a virtual currency or a crypto currency?
Yeah, it is based on blockchain, which is.
No. Is this cryptocurrency like Bitcoin?
Yeah. Yes.
Is this like Bitcoin?
Yeah, where there's no cash actually, which is.
Okay. So how many pre-mined currency? Is this pre-mined or do you do proof of stake, proof of work? What do you do?
Yeah, currently it's in the proof of prototype stage.
No. Bitcoins are all proof of work. You can't mine. There are 21 million bitcoins. Beyond that, you can't mine.
Yeah, okay.
So what's your way of mining that crypto which you have created?
We don't want to, give a value for we want to start up with sending one coin for 10 rupees and in a unit like that. And if we have more market for it.
There's nothing called one coin for 10 rupees. I mean, do you understand crypto?
Yeah.
Okay, blockchain, do you use Hyperledger, multi-protocol, what do you use?
Yeah, that would be a public ledger. We don't want to.
Public, all
in a
blockchains are public ledger. Within that, what's the technology that you will use?
We want it to be in a secure distributed network where peer-to-peer people can.
Do you really understand blockchain and cryptos?
Yeah.
Have you worked on it?
We want to work on that model so it's easy for everybody to.
This is all PPT. You don't even know ABC of this. You don't even know ABCD of blockchain nor cryptocurrency. You just whatever copy paste. You are talking app, you are talking virtual, you are talking crypto. You don't even know. I mean, what are you trying to pitch here?
The virtual currency for various services and also, to credit currency to peers on the app and portal.
It does not work that way. Bitcoins work very differently. There are 120 plus altcoins besides Bitcoin which exist in world. And each coin has its own use.
I know it's like it can be used for various purpose and track.
Don't feel disheartened. The only thing what Sanjay wanted to convey, you should have more knowledge on what you want to do before you present to this audience or this jury member. That's all.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Anyways, I was so happy listening a blockchain, because I invest in cryptocurrencies. I actually invest in cryptocurrency. I was thinking, saying that, will I see a first Indian crypto? But you just shattered.
Thank you very much. We welcome our next finalist on stage, Gopal Paul from Calcutta, representing EasyFizo Travel Solutions.
Hello. Good morning. Good morning. My idea, my startup name is EasyFizo. The idea is creating nowadays what schools are feeling and colleges are feeling is education. We have to take the students to field and give them proper knowledge rather than giving them boring classroom sessions. Now they are planning for educational trips every year, but they end up organizing some leisure tours. So we are tying up with different colleges, professors, scientists, and creating educational travel models. Whatever they learn on their books, we take them to field and give them that thing. Now thing is like that, we can take those students to field, we can give them that knowledge in their classroom directly with VR and AR model by creating all these things. And those who are really interested in traveling, they can directly book for solo backpackers, they can directly book for one person from our site. So in one word, is a educational travel platform in India for the first time. It's a solo backpackers booking site for the first time in India. And it's a virtual reality educational field trip site where you will able to know about fossil hunting, ISRO, space tour, and all these things from your classroom for the first time in India. The problem I already mentioned that you will find. So first I will go into team section that we have a very strong team of 7 members right now who are mainly from 7 different sector, marketing to computer science to business background and technology. So the problem that schools are facing is noticed by organizations like Cox and Kings, and they are planning to invest 500 crores in India for educational trips to create museum education in India in 2018. So this is a very good time to invest on this kind of platform where we can create, we have a connection, very good connection with schools and colleges, principals, scientists. We can create beautiful contents. We can take students to the next level, give them proper education like this way before they enter into this market. So right now it's a market of 35,000 crore every year, because there are almost 10% schools are increasing every day in India. Every year, sorry.
30 seconds left.
So I will go. So right now we have won many competitions. We already earned 7 lakh rupees revenue within 2 months of our operation. We already did virtual and field trip with colleges and schools, and right now we had seed funding from IIM Calcutta Innovation Park. We are partnered, and we are also tie up with Microsoft BizPark as a BizPark startup. We tie up with different photography and top level institute like ISRO, GSI, JSI, and IIT Kharagpur, IIT Bombay, Jadavpur University. So it's growing. We have already have contents, and we are entering to schools, and we are getting calls frequently right now.
Just a small correction. You said you have no competition. So I went to Google, and I typed educational tours for student in India, and it's never-ending list.
No, the thing is that there are educational trip providing site. They are just like agent. You will go there, you will not find fossil hunting trip with professors. You will find Digha tour for students. Like they will take your student for Digha for a recreational tour. The concept is different. We are taking them for proper education, which the modules will be created by the professors and scientists, and they will learn fossil hunting. Like they will know how fossils have been collected. They will know about space, because we will give them virtual kits in Himalaya so that they can able to see what star that is, how they are moving.
For using virtual kits, why do I need to go Himalayas? I can do sitting here.
Yes, that also we are providing, like in.
So you are telling across saying that somebody will go to Himalaya to look at using the virtual trips.
There you will see the clear sky. We will look the stars, and then I will give you that kit. So you will know from that this star is this one. So if you want to see that from your classroom, you can do, because we already did that. So like in Kalimpong, those kids never went to.
Coming back to, okay. How did you arrive at this 35,000 crore number?
Actually, I had that in my slide. I will show you that there are schools, and if I take every school went for educational trip every year, if I let's take 10,000 bucks from each school, so that's why the total market size is almost 35,000 crore. The number of schools, top
this
schools.
This number is your arrived.
No. I did surveys, so I have that in my slides. If you want to see, I will show you that thing also. And all these things, COCCAN, these are also collected from proper web sources.
I have two questions. First, as he said, there are many sites for educational tours. So what is the innovation element in this, which makes it different from, you know, normal education tour site? And second, what exactly is the revenue model? Why there will be more demand for this? How this will create more demand, and you know, how will you make it sustainable?
I will tell you. First thing is, like, there are agents who nowadays provide leisure tours in name of educational trips. These trips will be different, that I explained. Second thing is, nowadays what I faced in going to schools and pitching this educational trip, they are facing two big problems. One is time, and second is security, and the parents, mainly the parents of girls, they are not allowing girls to go for educational trips. Now we bring that virtual thing where we create videos virtually with professors in different aspects like engineering, science, arts, whatever that is, and we can teach them from their classroom itself, showing them the real actual feelings of that field. So they will learn about their textbook things watching all these contents. So like educational trip maybe in Sundarban for global warming will cost you around 2,000 bucks for every student. Now I can show you the entire thing delivered by a professor or scientist, and you can take 2-day session on that thing with different presentations, with bringing professor and scientist into your classroom at 300 to 400 bucks, because there is no logistics cost. I already have that content. So it's the revenue model is hyper. There is B2B model where we are tying up with school for virtual classes, and there we are taking schools to field work directly with professors. So one is a bit pocket friendly, that mainly rural school like Himalayan school, they will never able to visit Sundarban or ocean. So they will able to see what actual scenario is. And if you go to Sundarban, you will find there are students will not able to see in their entire life what Himalaya looks like. I bring Himalaya to their villages.
So there are two concepts embedded in this. One is education tour. Another is the, you know, distance learning.
Yes.
So you are combining two, saying it's a new concept. Huh?
No. Distance, it is not distance learning.
No.
It's virtual.
If I have to learn virtually, I can learn through the, you know.
You will not get contents. You will not get that content, because I will create that content from ISRO scientists. I will create like discovery and.
Thank you. We welcome our next finalist on stage, Parthasarathi Nag from Calcutta, representing United Strings.
Good afternoon, everyone, and very good afternoon to the esteemed jury member. Mm. I am Partho. I represent United Strings Automotives Private Limited. We are currently working on a solution called Fix My Ride, which is, to describe it, many of us here, we own cars, and we, amongst our hustle and bustle of our professional and personal life, we don't find adequate time to get our car serviced or repaired, or any emergency. You have to make multiple calls to get it hauled. So we have a one-stop solution wherein you can get your car serviced, cleaned, or your automobile needs at your doorstep or your emergency requirement at your convenient time, location, and date. And basically, this we have two different models here. One, where we have our own captive fleet catering to the customer requirements. Number two, we have service partners who would provide major services with regards to if your car needs a major overhaul. Because there are minor servicing like lube chains or sanitization of your car, AC cleaning that can be done at your doorsteps. However, there are major repairs like maybe some dent and paint or suspension repair where the car needs to be lifted on a post and, you know, dismantled to get it repaired and put it back together. For those, we have appointed service partners. So currently we are at, you know, testing the logistics. We have, it's just been 15 days we are testing it out, and with our own team. We are in the process of, you know, signing up service partners all across Kolkata. And, you know, to come down to the team, we have about 20 member team, but I have cited about 8 members here, ranging from marketing, customer service, development team. And if I go back to the innovation part of the thing, which was a definitive question here, a condition. Mostly, I wouldn't say it is completely unique. There are similar kind of services offered by dealer points or manufacturers or OEMs themselves, and there are other competitors working in other parts of India, but not in the eastern part or the northern part primarily. So what we are trying to do is, with our approach, because everywhere where the customer is connecting with us, we call it the touch points, be it the website, the application, the helpline on a customer service care, or the service points, we are trying to make it more hassle-free and seamless for the customer, where we are trying to bring in more transparency, rather I may call it bring in some method to the madness, because most of us, we would have experienced taking the car down to the workshop entails about 3 to 4 hours, depending on the kind of service that you're doing.
30 and seconds left.
The prices are will vary from workshop to workshop, if I'm not talking about a dealer workshop. So we are trying to bring in some regulation, transparency, and convenience above all to car owners. Yeah, that's about it. I would like to invite some questions. And if I may be allowed by the esteemed jury member to play a short video of a minute.
What's your cost of customer acquisition?
The cost of, we are working on that right now, to be very honest, because it's just been 15 days. We have started testing it out. We are developing the app right now, and we are working on the various channels through which we would acquire customers, be it through the social media, through traditional marketing, or, you know, through affiliate marketing.
What will be your profit margin for every service what you do?
It would range from 15% to 30% if you are doing it from this, through the service partners for major services. And with regards to our own captive fleet catering to the customers, the margins would vary depending on the service availed.
Will you be tying up with the branded garages or the local
Subsequently,
garages?
Subsequently, yes. Because there are certain manufacturers and models where, you know, owners prefer to be done at certified or authorized service centers. Subsequently, once we have established ourselves as a brand, we would definitely do that.
So you're still under the development, you're still developing the product, where there are many players already, in the market who has really gained momentum and doing really well, you know?
Yes, indeed. With our studies, we have seen, if I may be allowed to name few of them, Carzippy, Cartizan, Medicar, in Delhi. Most of the players are based out of Bangalore. Some in Pune, Indore, like Motor Babu, and we have Medicar predominantly doing really better than the competition up north. But the eastern India, the eastern part is still uncharted. And the success factor of this particular model is testified by the fact that Quikr recently acquired a company called Stepney, who works on the similar model. So
my question is, if there are so many players in the competitive landscape, and are you banking on that they are still not there in eastern India? Let's say one of them just raise a huge round of funding and send their troops painting the city with their brand and their team. So what's your USP and how will you handle that competitive landscape?
Again, as I said, it's not completely unique because this is already tested.
It's a Me Too. So it's a Me Too.
Yes.
It's a Me Too.
So, in this.
So, what's the innovation in that? Innovation means something which is not there, which is unseen, which you are seeing. So, what is that new thing that you're seeing? Because, to be very honest, I would rather go to those established players and invest because they have already developed traction. And if you're doing the same thing just by virtue of geography, why should I come and invest in you?
So, basically, it's with our approach of customer centricity and flexibility because. Having studied and observed the competition, they definitely, because of the time when they have launched and the tenure that they have spent in the market, they have definitely developed that traction. It is not only because of the geography. We are launching in Kolkata, consolidating here, but we are, in the second phase, we would look at moving out to the tier 2 or the tier 3 cities where similar requirements are present. Because most of the players here, they target the tier 1 cities because if you look at the total automobile scope, it's almost 20 million in India. And in Kolkata, it's close to 600,000 cars added almost every year. So we are looking at taking a step by one and then developing and moving out to tier 2 cities where similar requirements again capitalize there.
Tell me one thing.
Yeah.
Why somebody would give his or her car to you for the servicing and not go to the garage itself or to the showroom itself for the servicing? What is the main reason?
The first question here is if you have a very new car which you have bought out, it is definitely covered under warranty, and since we have not partnered with OEMs or manufacturers, those cars are definitely out of question. Cars which are older than 2 years or out of warranty cars, you usually scour through. If you have a good contact or a list of good garages, you would have to scour through various options.
We have branded showrooms. If I have a Hyundai car, I'll go to the Hyundai shop, you know.
Right.
So why would I give my car to you?
Number one, we would offer at similar services at a cheaper price point. Number two, if it is a minor service, say lube change or a basic maintenance, we would do it at your doorstep. Or maybe if you are at work and you have the car sitting idle for 2 to 3 hours, which at a disposal, we can get the service done there. So most of the, it is primarily convenience where things can be done.
So this is where I was coming to. So you, as a car owner, I would like my car to be going to Hyundai showroom or Hyundai recognized shop instead of being serviced by a local garage people. How would you tackle this? Like if I am having an Audi or a BMW, I would not like a local mechanic to touch it.
Definitely not, because there are certain technical requirements and premium cars are definitely not our target at this point of time. We are looking at domestic cars. Eventually, when we develop the skill set to cater to such requirements, we would be looking at partnering with the manufacturers or the dealer points to cater our services. Because similar models, there are options where, you know, our model or our services can be availed by dealer point themselves. So that is the target where we want to move to.
Do you think this business can survive till 2025?
Yes, sir, it would expand. We would innovate and evolve.
Have you heard about a car company called Tesla?
Yes, sir.
How many moving parts does Tesla have?
So I am not a mechanical person, so I am not completely aware of that.
Only 20 moving parts, and it gives lifetime warranty. Lifetime warranty, 20 moving parts. By 2025, all our cars will be electric. This whole business, what you are trying to, it's a shrinking market, not a growing market. Anyways, that's a different topic. Good luck. Thanks.
Thank you.
I just wanted to know, you said you will be expanding it to tier 2, tier 3 cities. You have not worked on your revenue model yet.
Yes, sir. We are testing it out.
Can you tell me why these established players in this same business are not expanding to tier 2 and tier 3 cities?
So primarily, having observed the established players in the market so far, they are targeting to go into the tier 1 cities primarily.
Why?
Because of the logistical reasons. But what we are trying, not only do we need to look at launching the business, but we also need to look at the feasibility and the potential return that we can get or the penetration that we can achieve out of the launch. So that is why instead of tier 1, we are looking at tier 2 or a tier 3 city.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We welcome our next finalist on stage, Pradeep Kumar Mukherjee from Calcutta, representing 4XTM Private Limited.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I, Pradeep Mukherjee, I'm going to present you a mobile app-based Forex remittances business. Basically, we want to dominate the mobile app-based Forex remittance space and enable users to migrate their one-off and monthly remittances to smartphones and cloud-based technology, and doing so create a massive new revenue stream for the business and savings in remittance cost to manual limits for the users. The problem is taking safe, cheaper online Forex remittances to smartphones and enabling it in real time. If a prospect can remit money to his home country, or a parent can remit to his or her ward who is studying abroad a small amount of money at a very small cost, and instantaneously he or she should be subscribing to our channel. We propose to use Ripple protocol, which is a standard which has already been developed on blockchain concepts, and this will significantly contribute in cross-border remittances with respect to cost and operational process. The uniqueness. Today, banking channels are prohibitively expensive for remittances. The cost of sending money is almost the same whether the remitter wants to remit $100 or $1,000. We plan to be aggregator of small remittances. Say, for example, from node A to node B, we will prefund the inward remittances at node B, say, when the information is transmitted to node B recipient by the remitter at node A. We shall be hosting all the data in the cloud and use only the banking channel for end of day aggregated transactions. So at end of day, our ledger balances will be adjusted to reflect the actual fund position at each node. Our pre-funding of transaction will be to nullify the delay of a banking channel. Our mechanism will ensure instantaneous receipt of remittances by the target customer, and the pre-funding money will be balanced by the end of the transaction. Revenue model, we intend to generate revenue on the basis of per transaction basis and membership fees for customers with high quantum money transfer. We will charge a transaction fee lower than that of banks and Western Union and keep it at par with cross-border real-time mobile app-based businesses, which will eventually be the leader in the space in the future.
30 seconds left.
We are targeting a volume business in the future which will make our EBITDA attractive to investors. At the G20 2011 summit in Keynes, Bill Gates stated that if the transaction cost on remittances worldwide were cut from where they are today at around 10% to an average of 5%, it would unlock $15 billion a year in poor countries. Global migrants are our major customers, and to start with, we want to capture a substantial market share of UAE-India remittance corridor, which is around $15 billion per annum at present. Our transaction cost is targeted to be between 2% and 3%. Conservative revenue, year 1, 2, 3, we are targeting EBITDA of 2 million, 6 million, and 20 million respectively.
So what is your current status?
It's in ideation stage. On the process of developing the MVP, minimum viable product.
Do you understand that to use the Ripple protocol, which you have mentioned across, all the banks needs to be on the Ripple protocol? Otherwise, you will not be able to transfer the money.
No, it's sorry to differ, because Ripple protocol is used by EBS, and they are trying with many prime international banks, but none of the Indian banks, they use that. And secondly, most of the banks have a corresponding bank. Ripple basically disrupts the banking system and gets rid of the corresponding bank concept.
Agreed. But on both the sides, so receiving and sending side, so you will have a corridor, let's say from UK you want, or UAE you want to send across the money, you will collate into one bank and then do a SWIFT to the local bank here, which will get replaced by Ripple. But if both the banks are not on Ripple, it cannot transfer.
No, no. Initially, we will go through a banking system, because when we start, we will not have that much power to negotiate with Ripple. Later on, we want to directly deal with Ripple and not go through banking system. For that, we will have to take necessary permission from RBI and others. Initially, we might plan to go for 18 fully convertible countries, you know, where there are no legal restrictions. So in that case, I am trying to do the proof of concept between Dubai and Singapore, and later on come to India when we get RBI permissions.
I have one question here.
Yes, sir.
Which is, of the many ifs that is there in your plan, because it's still in concept stage, one big if is that money transaction involves significant amount of trust by the consumer. Frankly speaking, I think price is not a criteria at that point in time. It is assurance and certainty that I'm sending to my fork $500, that it should reach that recipient. How do you build such a brand? How do you build that trust? It's a very long cycle and high investment game.
Sir, when Paytm started, on the first day, they had only 40 transactions, and that was within a closed group. I want to build up a closed group of 2,000 people who will be through acquaintances, and we will build up the trust with known people. Trust cannot be built overnight. So it will have to build up step by step, like Paytm did from 2010. Now they have won the trust across the nation. There is no quick fix solution available with me. I can only go with a trusted group of people who will start depending on me, our solution. And mind you, we are going to charge 2%. Today, if you want to remit $1,000 to UK, or USA, it will cost you around $35. If you want to remit $50, even then the cost is $35 or $25.
Who else is doing the similar thing in India?
Our main, on the brick and mortar is Western Union, who has an EBITDA of $5 billion.
They're dying, by the way.
But still they have an EBITDA of $5 billion in 2015. And our nearest competitor is TransferWise, which is based out of UK, but they operate in UK EU region and UK USA region. And Richard Branson has invested £25 million into this enterprise, but they are still EBITDA negative. And they have raised total funding of around $90 million.
Thank you. I request Reshmi Nath from Kolkata, representing Astria Solutions, to pitch her idea.
Hello. Good afternoon. My name is Reshmi Nath, and I'm one of the co-founders of Dabadigo. So let's start with a question. What motivates someone to purchase a vehicle? The obvious answer that comes to mind is convenience. Convenience of not having to stand in line, convenience of not having to go by somebody else's schedule, and so on. Now, but not everyone can afford to buy a vehicle. And even if they could, many people don't want to go through the hassle of obtaining a license. What if there was an option that was as convenient as having your own vehicle and for a fraction of the cost, and it was super fun to ride, and it didn't even require a license to ride? Introducing Dabadigo. It is an app-based zero-emission electric scooter rental service that is as convenient as having your own vehicle, and at 45 rupees an hour or 300 rupees a day, it is as affordable as almost as affordable as public transport. And to top it off, it's zero emission, so possibly one of the most eco-friendly ride that you would step into, at least in near future. These scooters can be picked up and dropped off from multiple locations. They come with GPS tracking and remote start and stop, and of course, integrated with mobile wallet. So what this means for our customers is they get an affordable, convenient, contemporary, and definitely really, really fun way of commuting. And for our business customer, this means an on-demand, scalable fleet that can be tracked and monitored for increased Salesforce profitability and accountability. And of course, no capital investment required. Our monetization is two-pronged, and I can get into this a little bit later. The monetization is from two sources. One is from our self-owned fleet, and then also the second is from franchisee-owned fleet. So we are also going to have a franchisee model. This is first of its kind in India, and an innovative disruptor that we believe will change the way urban transportation works. In our next phase, we want to expand this to other electric vehicles. So for example, electric cars, electric high-speed scooters, and maybe even electric jet skis, for all you know. And want to develop this brand into a world-class brand that the youth can identify with. Our true measure of success will come if we can have enough usage of this service so that we can make a visible impact on the air quality around us. And just to give you an idea, these are some of our happy customers who really, really love our product. We have just been operational for roughly 3 weeks, and we have seen huge response from the POV that we have done, just one point that we have opened so far. And with that, I'm open to questions. Oh, by the way, if anybody wants to see, we have one of the scooters in the parking lot outside.
So how many such scooters do you have currently?
Right now, we are just doing a proof of concept, so we only have 6 scooters. We have tied up with Hero Electric, and we can get more as soon as we are ready. So
tell me one thing, if you are not funded for next 6 months, how many scooters you can possess?
50 is what we are going for from friends and family, and we're hoping to get funded before that so that we can expand this as quickly as possible. But then not really though, 50 of our own scooters, but then we also have a franchisee model. So through the franchisee model, we have talked to many proprietors in different areas, especially people who already have these scooters. So we talked to one person who already, you know, who imported a fleet of 50 scooters from China, and he, you know, he meant to sell it. So we want to talk to him and see if he would want to set up a point. And this is in Murshidabad, so if he would like to set up something. So, yeah.
How do you go about, what's the deal mechanics in terms of you make a profit out of every transaction? What's your unit profitability? How do you acquire your customer? And finally, in terms of what's your validation saying that this customer will not run away or taking the theft? I mean, how do you maintain, what's your safeguarding?
Absolutely. So I'm just going to answer with the last question. How do I make sure that the customer is not going to run away with my product? First and foremost, when they come in, they have to give us or show us two original forms of IDs. So we take a photograph of those IDs. We take a photograph of the person itself. And then these scooters are also equipped with GPS tracking and remote immobilizer and also geofencing. So I can see at any point of time, I can see where this person is going. And if I see that, you know, I'm not able to reach this person or somehow not able to, you know, think that it's somehow not going by what we want, we can remotely just, you know, immobilize the scooters.
Other questions? You need profitability. How do you acquire customers?
So far what we have seen, we have done online and offline, you know, marketing. And what worked for us so far is offline. So we have put up right around the area. We have put up, you know, banners and hoardings, and that works really well. And word of mouth, you know, this is something so unique and new that if somebody uses it, they become our brand ambassador. They want to go and tell their friends. So, and also, you know, every time they rent, at the end of the rental, they are asked if they want to forward it to their friends. And obviously, they get a free ride for every time a new friend signs up. And I did not understand your question about unique profitability. What do you?
So every transaction, how much money do you make?
So I'll tell you this. I've not calculated that per se, but the way we do it is, if our scooters are at 40% utilization, then we break even. So for every rental point, you know, if the scooters are roughly utilized for 4 to 5 hours, we break even and make, you know, enough profit to cover operating costs.
How much you charge per hour?
45 rupees an hour and 300 rupees a day.
And how much is the cost of a scooter?
So far, it's around roughly 50,000, but we're in negotiation with Hero. Actually, the reason, you know, we conceptualized this idea earlier on this year, but then the reason it took us so long is because we've been working with Hero to kind of come up with the product that works best for us. So these are scooters powered by lithium ion battery. And the best part is the batteries are interchangeable. So let's say somebody brings in a scooter that is, you know, at 20% charge. We don't have to wait for it to charge. So we can just, you know, have a fully charged battery in there and the scooter is good to go.
A ballpark, in the last 3 to 4 months of the customers that you have got, it's a combination of repeat customers and new customers.
Repeat and new.
So can you give me a sense of that, and how much of that is repeat and how much of that is new customers?
So we have just started operation just for 3 weeks now. And in the last 3 weeks, I would say 60% repeat customers and 40% new customers. And of them, you know, very heavy on, you know, business customers. So restaurants and, you know, local Swiggy guys who really, really love our product, you know, just for their delivery and such.
Thank you. One tactical question. Do you do let's say somebody, you know how you get a license in India. Do you do a little bit of test whether he can really ride or not?
Of course. And we have had to refuse people. So when a customer comes for the first time, we ask them to take it for a ride. And, you know, our guy would just watch you and make sure that you are, you know, following the rules. And, you know, you're actually able to balance it properly and you're able to ride properly. And we only give you the ride, the rental, only if you are reassured that you are able to ride properly.
How much is the geographical area in which you plan to operate? That you said there is a geofence in which...
Right now, the geofence is actually very fluid. So it is, you know, it's quite broad right now. So you know, Kolkata and Salt Lake, but we can tweak that if you want.
And what if somebody hires on rent and then want to drop at another point?
So eventually we will have that. So what we plan on doing is we want to have one point every 5 kilometers, but that's going to be, you know, once we get funding.
It's pretty much like Zipcar, am I right? Something like that.
Absolutely. It's very much like Zipcar for electric scooter rental. So we want to completely keep to electric vehicles because we think, you know, obviously that's the future.
Have you pitched to Hero Motors Munjals because they fund startups? Have you pitched to them?
We are, no, we have not pitched to anyone yet, actually.
How much funding are you looking for?
We're looking for, to start off with, maybe 1.5 to 2 crores. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. May I now request Sankalpa Das from Kolkata to give his presentation, to give his pitch.
Hello everyone, I am Sankalpa. I want to start off with a very basic property of a human being, that is curiosity in culture, be it their own culture or be it the culture of some other race or religion. So what we want to do is, and one more thing is, festivals are a very integral part of culture, and festivals are celebrated across the world throughout the year. And we as human beings want to be part of it. But unfortunately, we can't do that because first thing is we can't travel everywhere. And second thing is, even if we do travel, like for example, in our yearly Durga Puja, it's a huge amount of crowd that really blocks our plan, that we cannot travel to each and every pandals, we cannot hop each and every pandals and then have a sight. So to tackle that problem, the idea that I'm going to pitch here is kiosks with virtual reality mechanism that will enable the user to experience the pandals, or let's say the place of the festival, the place of the attraction, as if he is there. So that's what the virtual reality does, right? That it is, it will give you an impression that you are really in that particular place, and you can have a first-hand experience of the thing that you want to. So these virtual reality kiosks will be based on revenue models. For example, the primary revenue model will definitely come from the tickets sold. People will come, they will have to buy tickets, and then they will have to go in the kiosk for to experience that for a certain amount of time. And gradually, when that idea picks up, we will be having a source of advertising revenue once that is popular. And then we'll have a secondary source of revenue as advertising. We know that this particular idea has a lot of competition. For example, people can sit in their home and watch TV. We have internets nowadays. And we really have a common perception that getting virtual is not as good as getting into the real place. So to tackle those, we are planning to make it more attractive, and also it will be based on different amount of festivals that we are going to cover. So for example, let me give a common statistics that in Mumbai in 2015 there were around 1 lakh footfall during Durga Puja. And so that means that 1 lakh people had traveled to different Durga Pujas in Mumbai to enjoy the festival. Now, if we can let the virtual reality kiosk have them experience the Durga Puja in India itself, in Kolkata itself, then we have a selling point.
30 seconds left.
So that's how we want to do it in an incremental basis. We want to target few festivals and few places, and then gradually we want to pick up, and then we want to enhance it to more festivals, and different regions will be brought in on board so that this experiencing, distance experiencing through virtual reality kiosk really picks up, and then the potential would be realized. So with that, I complete my presentation. Thank you.
I'm just asking one question.
Yeah.
You told this virtual reality is very close to reality, am I right? That's what
yeah.
you're saying.
Yeah.
But I'm just curious, will I pay in a kiosk instead of having the real fun of seeing the Egdalia
right.
Park Pujo?
Yeah.
The whole fun is that 1 hour of walk and then the smell of puchka and all those kind of stuff.
Yes.
So how will you bring all that in the kiosk? The smell, the noise, the aroma, the sweat, I mean, how will that come? I can get that.
Yes, I do agree with it that we really cannot go to the, I mean, the experience cannot really be compared between virtual and real. Apples to apples comparison cannot happen, that I agree. But I know of many people who want to go to that place, want to experience that, but due to the crowd, due to their own limitations, they're not able to do it. So it's just about helping people experience more. And in the process, it's like we are enjoying together. So nobody is left out. So
it's good to have product. So will it be sustainable from a revenue model? How many people are willing to pay for Durga Pujo in New York and pay, say, 500 rupees in this room and ask them to raise the hand, 500 or 1,000 rupees? Because the capex that you will roll out for those 2 days is a gear, am I right? It's the virtual reality gear and all those kind of stuff, rental, lease, etc., etc. Just to recover that, I don't know what the economics is. It's I didn't hear that. So have you validated such ideas?
No, it's first of all, it's in the idea stage. So I cannot tell a first-hand experience. But there are really two costs associated with this particular idea. One is off-site cost, another is on-site cost. Off-site cost in the sense that we need to have cameras that will record those events from different angles. And only then it will be applicable as a fee to the virtual reality kit, which that particular people will have to wear to really experience that. So that is, but these two costs are really fixed cost in nature. So once we are able to roll out this particular idea to a certain amount of people, then I think we'll be able to break even. And then going forward, we will be able to generate some profit.
Can I ask you something?
Yeah.
Why, if really you want to bring that virtual experience, then why even want people to come to your kiosk? Why not give them sitting at home using their smartphone? My question is that. Why
I
do
think,
I need to come to your kiosk?
You are right. But what I feel is that, again, I'm going back to the basic human nature.
Actually, he basically said short of why not YouTube, basically, which is free.
Yeah, I know, but then YouTube will again give you a two-dimensional experience, right? It will.
Please understand, you know, to scale up, you're not solving a need. It is a good to have kind of a thing, you know.
Yes.
So, you know, if any investor is going to look into it, is it a necessity or is it solving a problem which can be scale up for an investor's point of view, you know?
To be honest, I am not solving a basic need. That is true. But what I feel is that if this particular idea can be rolled out and once it becomes a bit viral, then it should catch up and it should be able to scale up to a certain extent. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We would now like to request our last finalist of Nish Nawar representing PlayBuddy to pitch his idea.
Good evening, everyone. I'm here to talk about PlayBuddy. My name is Avnish. I just finished my studies. My other founding partner is Suyash Tibrewala. So we both are founding partners of this app called PlayBuddy. Let me explain this to you, my app through a small story. A few months back, my friend was throwing a birthday party, and he wanted to throw a birthday party of basically he wanted to call people and play cricket. But in today's age, as you all know, people don't go out and play sports as much as they used to before. So we couldn't throw the birthday party because there weren't enough people to play cricket with. So hence we thought that why don't we make an app in which we can, you know, connect people who want to play sports with each other, because I think it's very important to play sports because I've played sports all my life and I still want to, and I really don't find people to play sports with. So the problem we're trying to solve today is basically to help people to play their favorite sports with. In a sample size of over 200 people, from the age of 18 to 30, 68% of the people actually said that they actually have a problem in playing sports because they don't find people to play with. So it is a problem in my generation today that people can't really go out and play out there. So our product is innovative in the sense that it really aims to improve the lifestyle of young students, working professionals from the age of 18 to 30 or even more, by giving them a chance to play their favorite sports with and while making new friends as well. So I think this is a good combination that we have here to offer to them, because they can make new friends and play their favorite sports. So as per our research in the market, currently in India there are no really major sporting apps. There is one in Bangalore called PlayU, but it's not really been active over the last 2-3 months from what I've seen. There are obviously many apps like this in different places across the world, like it's there in America, it's there in Europe. There are apps like these, but nothing major in India right now. So the main aim that we want to generate revenue is through different membership options that we'll offer to our customers. We'll have a premium membership, which is people will have to pay a slight fee for this, and we'll have a regular one, which will be complimentary. And the other one is that we'll have a big user base on our app, and we're confident that once we have that big user base, sporting companies like Adidas or Nike, they'll be wanting to have access to that user base. So they'll be willing to advertise on our platform to have access to that user base.
30 seconds
left. I feel that there is potential of success for the app, because on the basis of the research I did in the market, and I feel that sports is going out of the lives of many people from my generation. So I feel that if sports can come back in their lives, our app can become successful once. So that's about it. Thank you.
So what is the current status of your app?
So we just started making it. It's been about just 2-3 months.
Just an idea?
No, we did research. We are in the process of finalizing an app developer. So we know our basic features as I mentioned before, but we're in the process of just about to start making the app right now. So we are very new to this, but we are very passionate about it.
My question is, why do you have to develop an app? I mean, nobody downloads the app because you have an app. You can use a microsite, which will take 2 days to figure out whether this works or not.
No, but I think with the app it's more organized. You can make teams. You can make better friends, so that you can even communicate with them a little better with the app. In the site, it'll be a little difficult to, you know, contact each other and stuff like that. So with the app, I think it'll be slightly easier to contact each other and make life. I think in my view, the app will make life simpler for the consumer. And since I'm going out in the market, I want to go fully. I don't want to do it half-heartedly. So if I feel there's a demand for it, I would rather make an app and go, and rather than just making a small site. That's what I feel. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, with this, ladies and gentlemen, dear delegates, we come to the end of our pitches. We thank our panel of jury for their time. The scores will now be tabulated, and the final winners will be announced at the awards ceremony, which will take place at a later part today evening. We request you to kindly remain seated. We will now have the spotlight session, self-transformation leading to societal transformation, and our keynote speaker is Yogashi Swami Ramdev Ji.